Elliptical geometry and raised rims are two characteristic features of well-preserved Carolina bays. The Carolina bays are conic sections because they originated as inclined conical cavities. The elliptical geometry of the Carolina bays can be confirmed by fitting ellipses to the geological features. This presentation describes the fitting procedure. Welcome to another edition of the Carolina Bay of the Day, where we study the secondary impacts made by the glacier ice boulders that were ejected by one or more extraterrestrial impacts on the Laurentide ice sheet by the Great Lakes. The secondary impacts produce seismic vibrations that liquefied unconsolidated soil, and the oblique impacts of glacier ice created inclined conical cavities that became shallow elliptical basins by viscous relaxation. In Nebraska, these basins are called rainwater basins, and along the Atlantic coastal plain, they are called Carolina Bays. LIDAR is a laser ranging technology that makes it possible to visualize slight changes in elevation. This LIDAR image shows the Nebraska rainwater basin with its typical raised rims and elliptical geometry. The southern end appears to have a double rim, but this is due to the degradation of the terrain by water erosion. Nevertheless, an ellipse can be fitted to follow the margin of the basin very closely. This is very remarkable for a geological feature that has a length of 2,760 meters, or about 1.7 miles. The width-to-length ratio of the ellipse corresponds to a cone inclined at 42.5 degrees. This is the impact angle at which a projectile could have made a conical cavity with these width and length characteristics. This impact basin is located 17 kilometers southwest of Wichita, Kansas. Its northwest rim is eroded, but otherwise its elliptical geometry is well defined. Mathematically, 5 points are needed to define an elliptical curve, so an ellipse can be fitted to an elliptical feature even if the feature is partially degraded. The raised rims are characteristic of impacts because impact cratering displaces material laterally by horizontal compressive forces and ejects debris ballistically to produce stratigraphically uplifted rims. This LIDAR image of Carolina Bays near Bowmore, North Carolina, has examples of bays that overlap in various ways. The thicker rims on the southeast end of the basins can be clearly seen. Time after time, we can see that well-preserved Carolina bays of different sizes can be fitted with ellipses that closely follow the rims of the structures. The enormous size of the basins can be appreciated by comparing them to the rectangular feature, which is a complex of barns measuring about 680 meters. Some geology books say that the Carolina bays are thaw lakes like the ones found in northern Alaska that form when underground ice melts and creates sinkholes that fill with water and are often aligned downhill or with the prevailing wind. We will now look at the north coast of Alaska next to the Beaufort Sea, which has a large number of thermokarst lakes that have been compared to the Carolina bays. Most of the border between Alaska and the Canadian Yukon Territory is defined by the 141st meridian west of Greenwich, which goes directly to the North Pole. As we zoom in on the northern coast of Alaska, we can see many lakes of different sizes and shapes. Some of the larger lakes measure more than 4 kilometers in length. The lakes are oriented toward the sea, and there are also several meandering streams that terminate at the Beaufort Sea. The idea that thermokarst lakes are oriented with the prevailing wind is not correct in this case. The orientation is toward lower terrain. The lower left corner of this image is at an elevation of 31 meters above sea level, and the elevation on the upper right corner is at 5 meters above sea level. The flow of the streams and the orientation of the thermokarst lakes is toward lower terrain. The wind may have some influence on the orientation of the lakes, but gravity, rather than wind, is the dominant force responsible for the orientation because water flows downhill. Thermokarst lakes take a variety of shapes. Here is one shaped like a duck. And here is another thermokarst lake shaped like an arrowhead. This one looks like a planarian worm. There are some thermokarst lakes that have an oval shape, but they do not have the raised rims or the precise elliptical geometry of conic sections like the Carolina Bays. This side-by-side comparison of LIDAR images of Alaskan thermokarst lakes and Carolina Bays shows two completely different types of landscapes. The thermokarst lakes have ragged edges and irregular shapes, whereas the Carolina Bays have smooth elliptical shapes with raised rims. The Carolina Bays do not have unusual shapes like ducks, arrowheads, or planarian worms. They are mostly elliptical, except when they have been modified by erosion or movement of the terrain. The Carolina Bays can be fitted with ellipses to demonstrate that these geological features have indeed elliptical geometry. The most reasonable explanation is that the Carolina Bays are conic sections because they originated as inclined conical cavities. A LiDAR image that is overlaid by an ellipse can be evaluated for congruency. The evaluation is easier if the ellipse is only 50% opaque and it is slightly smaller than the Carolina Bay so that the rim of the bay can be seen clearly along the perimeter of the ellipse. Venn diagrams illustrate set relationships in logic, and they can be used for fitting ellipses to geological structures like the Carolina Bays and the thermokarst lakes in Alaska. For fitting ellipses to geological features, the ellipse should have the same area as the feature, and the intersection of the feature and the ellipse should be maximized. At the same time, the portions of the feature and the ellipse that do not intersect should be minimized and equalized. The best fit is obtained when the intersection is at a maximum and the parts that are not in common are equal and have a minimum area. The procedure for fitting ellipses can be illustrated with this wedge-shaped thermokarst lake in Alaska. First, we mark the margin of the lake and label it A. The ellipse is labeled B. If the ellipse is too big, it will encompass all the lake. The intersection of the lake and the ellipse is equal to the area of the lake. There is no area of the lake outside of the ellipse, and the area of the ellipse which is not part of the lake is colored pink. If the ellipse is too small, it will be completely inside of the perimeter of the lake. In this case, the intersection of the lake and the ellipse is equal to the area of the ellipse. There is no area of the ellipse outside of the lake, and the area of the lake which is not part of the ellipse is colored orange. The optimization of the ellipse fitting procedure can start when the area of the ellipse is equal to the area of the lake and the perimeter of the ellipse overlaps the perimeter of the lake. At this point, the intersection of the lake and the ellipse is small compared to the size of the areas that are not common. By moving the ellipse, we can cover a greater area of the lake. Although the common area has increased, the orientation is still not optimal. When the ellipse is aligned with the lake, there is maximum coverage of the intersection. At this point, the intersection of the lake and the ellipse are at a maximum, and the areas that are not common are approximately equal. Further refinements can be achieved by tweaking the aspect ratio of the ellipse while maintaining the same area. This means that any change in the length of the ellipse will require a compensating change in its width. An iterative series of adjustments in the position of the ellipse and its aspect ratio will eventually lead to the best possible fit. The remarkable characteristic of well-preserved Carolina bays is that the intersection of a bay and an ellipse is equal to the area of the bay with no area remaining outside or inside the ellipse. Do not let anybody tell you that the Carolina bays are thaw lakes or thermokarst. The geometry of the Carolina bays should not be ignored. The geometry tells us precisely that these geological features are impact structures. They are the scars of a catastrophe that triggered the extinction of the megafauna and the Clovis culture 12,900 years ago. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. I will continue to examine the Carolina Bays one bay at a time. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays.